Good evening. It is an absolute pleasure and an honor to be here with you here this evening in this very snowy and very reminiscent Christmas night. It looks like it's almost like that. It's that foreshadow of what's to come for this holiday. And really, it's not our first time here in the Niagara region. We've done quite a lot of work in the city of Welland with the churches there, and we do have a great connection there with the churches there, along with the Baptist denomination down there. And it really is a pleasure to come all the way from Toronto to be with you. We love this region, and we're very honored. So thank you to Calvin for the invitation, along with the senior pastor and the pastoral staff of this church. We're very privileged. With that, bit of an idea, Calvin did mispronounce our name, not so much in terms of its pronunciation, but more about its order. It's actually Evangelium and Apologia Ministries, and it is a tongue twister, I must admit. And really how we came across to that was really trying to find a name that was not common and yet unique. And we wanted the unique, but to such an extreme that people can't really pronounce it. So we've reduced it to either just E&AM or just E-A-M, which is very simple to pronounce, just simple acronyms. And we, again, do apologize in advance for that when you're trying to write that up on your checks or even when you're just trying to write us a letter or just pronounce or mention it to a friend in reference. Well, I'm not the only presenter today, as Calvin had mentioned. Lewis and George are also serving with us as apologists. My role is more of an evangelist with an apologetic approach to my ministry. Lewis, however, and George are also, with a heart for evangelism, are actually much more deep in apologetics. Lewis actually is studying at the University of Toronto and is expected to finish about this year with an undergraduate degree in history and Middle Eastern civilizations. While George is already a University of Toronto graduate with a Bachelor of Arts with honors in political science and ethics, society, and law. I'm actually a York University graduate in Bachelor of Human Resource Management, which, although unrelated to Christian ministry and apologetics, I am currently applying to pursue my Master's of Arts in Christian Apologetics in Veritas Evangelical Seminary. So we do have a very high regard in regards to the academics and being able to partner with other ministries as well in pretty much advancing the kingdom of God in a postmodern world. Well, our ministry, if you want a little bit more information about us, we are an apologetic ministry. And really, we concern ourselves with five main categories when it comes to defending the faith. Now, we go out to the public streets in downtown Toronto to witness, to hand out Bibles, to have conversations with people. But we've realized that a simple presentation of the gospel can often be insufficient in this world and this country simply because there are so many other obstacles and misconceptions that really apologetics is not trying to convince them, but rather trying to clear the obstacles so they have a clear, unobstructed view of who Jesus Christ is and what the biblical gospel really is. And part of our categories that we cover is, in fact, a biblical creation, biblical studies, comparative religions, Christian history, and theology and philosophy. But in tonight's topic that we've been requested to talk on is, in fact, the case for the resurrection. And it's been divided into three separate, even, segments that we'll each be covering. And really, the composition of this talk is on the historicity of the crucifixion. I mean, did it really take place? Was it really the Christ? The theories against the resurrection, which Lewis will be covering, and George will finally be delivering the final piece on the historicity and relevance of the resurrection. Well, with that, let's start with the primary passage of which we are basing everything on. And that's in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3 to 5, which reads the following. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Well, why study the crucifixion and resurrection? That's a question that we often get. And well, let's say what you're sharing your faith in the workplace, which is what you'll often do, or perhaps in your school, or even at a family dinner. You'll end up with a very similar scenario like this. And here we have Annie and Ben having a conversation, our two fictitious characters, but presenting a very real-life scenario. And Annie says, there really is a way that you can be forgiven of your sins and attain salvation. She's sharing her faith with Ben in an ongoing conversation. And says, if you repent of your sins and place your faith in what Christ did on the cross and through his resurrection, you can be saved. Of course, it's a very truncated version of the gospel, but Ben responds saying, well, look, I can see what you're saying, but unfortunately, I can't believe that. And he might say, why? Or you might say, why in a conversation? And they'll often say, well, because dead people just don't come up from the grave And if they did, it would be the walking dead in real life. Now, most people don't understand what the walking dead is, and for those who are younger, there's a show that apparently is a trend that we don't follow, but it's a zombie movie, and people tend to get this concept, well, if Jesus really did rise from the dead, he must have been a zombie of some sort. And of course, that results in people just not wanting to believe that Jesus came back from the dead. It doesn't seem realistic to them. But let's say, what if your conversation is with a more skeptical person, or perhaps a Muslim? And it happens to be a conversation between Joseph and Amar, and Joseph, being the believer, pretty much presents the biblical gospel, much like Annie did. And Amar, being a Muslim, or perhaps even being a skeptic, responds, well, how do you know that's true? I mean, how do you know for sure that it was Jesus on that cross and not another person? I mean, besides the whole rising from the dead, if they killed the wrong man, what would happen? What if they did kill the wrong man? Now, in truth, what I've really done is condense the conversation. You'll have a much larger, perhaps more drawn-out conversation than this, but this does get the essence of what the conversation would entail. And these are just examples of the kind of objections you're going to face when sharing or defending your faith. Now, what we've done tonight is really put together a tightly knit presentation that doesn't seek to prove the crucifixion and resurrection, but rather affirm its biblical truth. And there's a reason I mentioned that in all of our presentations, is because if we were to say that we're going to prove the Bible's gospel accounts would mean that, then the evidence becomes authoritative and not the Word of God. But we know that the Bible is the Word of God, but evidence simply just comes in to help us affirm what really happened. So we understand the Bible is the authority and is authoritative, and the evidence doesn't necessarily remove from its authority. And this is why everything we're presenting here in our case is to affirm that this really did take place, not necessarily to prove it, because we understand it is a revealed truth from the divine Spirit of God. Well, where do we begin if we're going to study the crucifixion and resurrection? Well, that's step number one, which is presenting the case for the crucifixion. The Christian faith finds its centrality in the personhood of Jesus. But it is the crucifixion and resurrection that actually lays the foundation for the whole of Scripture and for our faith here today. If the crucifixion were a hoax, let's say it was a fraud, as our Muslim friends may suggest, it would present the Christian faith as one of the cruelest acts of fraud in all of human history. If the resurrection was a lie, a distortion of the truth, then all that we believe in would be utterly useless. In fact, it was Paul who wrote to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14, if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is vain. Your faith also is vain. It's because of the importance of this Christian doctrine that both the crucifixion and the resurrection have been called into question by critics and skeptics. To destroy the crucifixion and resurrection would, in essence, be to destroy the foundation of the Christian worldview, hypothetically, because we know that can't be done. And that really is the motivating factor behind our critics and behind the skeptics. But to begin with the resurrection, the case for the resurrection, to begin at that point in time wouldn't do this case any justice. I mean, how can you really defend the resurrection if there wasn't an actual crucifixion? You know, there are multiple facets for the case for the crucifixion, but what I'd like to begin is with the execution practices of the Roman Empire. You see, the process of crucifixion was regarded as a Roman specialty. It was a slow, torturous death that exhausted the agonized body, and it was one of the most cruelest ways to die and the most humiliating. Now, regardless of what sources you could possibly consult, you'll always arrive to this one conclusion about the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire specialized in one thing, and they were very effective in this one thing. They were really good at killing people. Whether it was warfare, gladiatorial combat, scourges, or crucifixion, the many devices of the Romans were designed to kill, to shed blood, and to rob human life. But why were the Romans hated by the barbarians and natives of other lands? Well, besides heavy taxation being one of the causes and land invasion, they were also hated because of their cruelty and brutality. It was an empire built on military force and bloodshed. We're talking about, for entertainment, gladiatorial fights held in the Colosseum. and other local communities where people would just cheer on as one were killing each other to the death. It was savage. The death and slaughter revealed the brutality that characterized the Roman people. And it just so happened that to be crucified, as opposed to dying in battle, was to be mocked publicly, entertaining passerbys and also warning those who might oppose Rome or rise against the power of Rome. But how could it be? Perhaps in some form or fashion, our skeptics say, or even Muslim communities say, that Jesus Christ didn't actually physically die on the cross as they took him down from it. Some may see it as a possibility, which is why some claim that he was merely resuscitated after the resurrection. After the crucifixion. But there are historical and obvious logical problems that arise with this assumption. First and foremost, Roman soldiers were not known for doing an incomplete job. It was known historically, it was known culturally, it was known throughout time that when it concerned death, they were black belt masters, if you were to call them that. Secondly, there would be no gain whatsoever from a Roman standpoint in attempting to alleviate the Christ's suffering by faking his death. This would have resulted in the death of the soldier and those alongside him who either witnessed or partook in this act. Considering then that death was the Roman expertise, and that the penalty of failing to deliver that death would mean death itself, it's quite improbable that the Romans failed to do their job as they were ordered. Well, what about the mistaken identity theory? Perhaps it wasn't really Jesus on the cross to begin with. Although I've actually reserved this section for Lewis to go into much more detail and in much more depth, I did want to make mention of the historicity of Christ's death. Consider that there were eyewitnesses who affirmed Christ's death on the cross, such as Mother Mary, her sister Mary Clopas, Mary Magdalene, which we find in John chapter 19, verse 25, and even the Apostle John in verses 26 and 27. You see, to mistake the man on the cross with another was not only to threaten the lives of the Roman soldiers, but it was also something that could have actually provoked political instability within the region. And if the Jews had chosen to cause a riot as a result of this farce, Pontius Pilate would have been held accountable to Rome. Now, if you're familiar with the times, if you're familiar with the situation, they threatened to revolt on numerous occasions until they finally had the Roman and Jewish War in AD 70, which resulted in the fall of Jerusalem. And to upset the Jews in this manner, and when they were very set and determined to make sure that Jesus Christ was in fact crucified, if this was in some form or manner mistaken, if this was a mistaken identity, if this was fraud, they would have provoked a riot. But also consider that the recent Gnostic hype of the Gospel of Judas, which was not actually written by Judas Iscariot, despite its claim, also affirmed that Christ was betrayed for the crucifixion. Now, it's not necessarily safe or practical to use a Gnostic text to derive historical truths, considering it was more concerned with mysticism at the time. And the Gnostic belief in the Gospel of Judas presents the crucifixion as Christ's final step in liberating his divine soul from the fleshly prison of the human body. But despite its corrupted and non-biblical story, in fact heretical, it was a heresy by the early church, it was recognized and rejected, it does at least confirm the betrayal of Christ, which leads up to the crucifixion. And without a doubt, the crucifixion of Christ was not a mythological fairy tale. It was not some tale or a legend that someone decided to just whip up, but rather a historical reality in a definite geographical location concerning real flesh, real blood, and a real tomb. Well, the Greeks had their Mount Olympus to refer to. The Romans had their own elaborate stories of their gods. But the story of Christianity was a belief that concerned real events and was quite literally revolutionary. You see, the enemies of Christ were also real men with real political authority, real militaristic authority, not mystic or allegorical preachers like other religions of the time. In fact, what we can appreciate is that the Gospels are so incredibly detailed in its historical narrative that it provides a fuller picture than any other man's death in the ancient world. For example, Ignatius of Antioch, a student of John the Apostle according to early Christian tradition, affirmed the crucifixion as a real historical event. Historians Thallus and Phlegon both acknowledge the Gospel's event of the skies darkening upon the Christ's death, recording it with their own interpretations. In Luke, we actually read as confirmation of this in chapter 23, verse 44 to 45. It was now about the sixth hour, and darkness fell over the whole land until the ninth hour, because the sun was obscured, and the veil of the temple was torn in two. Quite significant that the gospel writer Luke here records this event in great detail, and we have other historians that can actually attest outside of the Bible that this, in fact, did take place. Even the Stoic philosopher, a Greek philosopher, Mara Bar Serapion, having lived in, within the first and second generation of eyewitnesses, affirmed Christ's crucifixion as a historical reality when writing a letter to his son. He also happens to mention other historical figures in the letter, such as the Greek philosopher Socrates and Pythagoras. They identified Christ as a very real person, and they identified his death as a very real event. Well, then there is no doubt historically about the reliability of the crucifixion, and that it really was Jesus on the cross, and that he died for our sins, fulfilling the law. Then how could we confirm the Christ's death? How could we be sure that he was taken down and that he was dead at that point in time? Well, let's start with what Christ endured before his crucifixion. If you recall, Christ was scourged prior to being condemned to the cross. And Louis Dizon will also be going into much more detail about this. But historically, the lashes or the flagrum that were often used by the Romans for scourging consisted of 39 lashes, historically. And this was often interwoven with metal and rigid bones. They were never designed to bruise. When you were whipped with this flagrum, with these lashes, it wasn't to put a bruise on your back or on your side or by your ribs. They were actually designed to shred human flesh apart. Well, what was the end result? Sometimes exposed skeletal muscles, bones, veins, and even internal organs were revealed. Well, medically speaking, victims of this cruel torture suffered what is termed as hypovolemic shock. And when an individual loses more than one-fifth of their body's blood, they enter into this state of shock. This state of shock results in kidneys shutting down, an unquenchable thirst, collapsing due to exhaustion, and a drop in blood pressure, resulting in a loss of consciousness. This is what happens when you lose more than one-fifth of your body's blood. We remember Christ saying that he was thirsty on the cross in John chapter 19, verse 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things had already been accomplished to fulfill the scripture, said, "I am thirsty." We remember that Simon of Cyrene was charged with helping in the carrying of the cross, likely because Jesus' physical inability to support its weight. Luke writes in chapter 23, verse 26, "And when they led him away, they laid hold of one Simon of Cyrene, coming in from the country, and placed on him the cross to carry behind Jesus." You see, the greater the loss of blood, the greater the symptoms of hypovolemic shock. And this is what Jesus Christ was likely experiencing. One of the consequences of this particular form of shock that the body can experience is an increased heart rate, which caused bodily fluids to accumulate around the heart and lung organs. Now, the medical and technical term for this is actually the pericardial effusion, referring specifically to fluids surrounding the heart, and the pleural effusion concerning the lungs. And the historical and medical evidence is actually revealed in John chapter 19, verse 34, which states, "But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out." How can we know that Jesus Christ was actually dead at that time? Well, the soldiers broke the legs of those crucified to prevent them from pushing themselves up for air. That's what they did, therefore causing suffocation. The argument at times presented is that since they didn't break Jesus' legs, perhaps he was still alive, just faintly surviving. But the historical and biblical account details that a Roman soldier pierced the side of Jesus to ensure that he was dead. And the fact that water and blood came out showed that clearly they had actually pierced the sack of fluid which actually surrounded the hearts and lungs. If Christ was still physically alive, he would have yelled or reacted in pain, but instead he was unresponsive. Now, in essence, we can conclude that Christ was in fact dead. And for those who claim that he wasn't by that time, that last pierce by the Roman spear would have ensured it. It would have ensured that he was in fact dead. And an injury that close to the heart and lungs would have been fatal, especially in a time period where medical knowledge was severely lacking in comparison to what we know today. In truth, the death of Christ, both historically and medically, there's no other way of getting around that. One, it was really Christ on that cross. And two, he really died. But another facet of the case for the crucifixion is the burial process of the crucified body. When Jesus was taken down from the cross, it was Joseph of Arimathea, a rich man, along with the believing Pharisee Nicodemus, who persuaded Pilate to grant them the body of Jesus for proper burial. Now, if we recall, Joseph was a member of the Jewish Sanhedrin, an honorable counselor in Mark chapter 15, verse 43, and a seeker of the kingdom of God, who donated his own tomb for the burial of Jesus Christ. Now, it's important to note that here are two individuals who are familiar with Jesus, both forming part of the religious authority system in some manner that crucified him, and both believing the claims of Christ as Lord God and Messiah. These two reputable, wealthy, and honorable men could testify with the utmost integrity that the body that they took was in fact the body of Jesus Christ. Also consider that Joseph of Arimathea would not have given his tomb to a foreigner that he did not know. And Nicodemus would not have endangered his life burying the body of the one who threatened the Jewish religious authorities if it were not really Jesus. Now, obviously, if you had a loved one who was at the point of death and was supposedly dead, you would check to see if the body was still alive. You would check for a pulse in some form or manner. And obviously, even those who were even doing the burial process would even check. But they would be sure when handling the body of Jesus was that he did in fact die. Furthermore, to have Roman soldiers guard the tomb was even greater importance, as it confirmed that one, the body that laid in the tomb was of immense value. Why else would you guard a tomb of some nobody or some figure that had no influence whatsoever? And secondly, that it was a potential threat to the political stability in the region of Judea. They were exercising their due diligence. They didn't want to receive a message from the Jews that they had mishandled this execution. Well, Roman governors or even Herod wouldn't bother to guard a tomb for a body that was not the real Jesus. It actually would have been a waste of human resources. And really, the evidence historically, medically, and even logically all affirm that Jesus Christ experienced a literal and physical death on the cross and was buried in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. And with this, we can proceed to step two on presenting and refuting the critics behind the crucifixion and resurrection. And with that, I'd like to ask Lewis to come to continue this section and our presentation.
Okay, so I'm here to talk about the alternative theories that most non-Christians will present in an effort to explain the circumstances behind the death and resurrection of Jesus. Because if you don't believe that Jesus rose from the dead, obviously you're going to have to try to explain what exactly happened. Now, how we know Christianity is true is that it alone can explain the historical realities as they really are. And all the non-Christian alternatives to the resurrection have varying degrees of plausibility, but really doesn't take all that much to make their inherent absurdity to be made plain. And there are countless alternative theories that are out there, and I'm gonna address four main theories. They are the stolen body theory, the swoon theory, the hallucination theory, and the Islamic substitution theory. Now, there are a lot of other theories out there besides these four, but they tend to be really small fringe theories. like before we came up with this presentation, Stephen asked me if I was going to do the twin brother theory, which is basically this theory that Jesus had a twin brother who mysteriously stayed out of the picture until Jesus died, and at which point this twin brother presented himself as the resurrected Christ. I don't think I need to go into detail about why that one is ridiculous. That being said, we shall concentrate on these four and show that the most commonly held theories on how to explain Jesus' death and the disappearance of his body apart from resurrection do not in fact make sense. We'll begin with the stolen body theory. And this happens to be one of the oldest alternative theories to the resurrection. We find it located in the text of the gospel itself, in Matthew 28, verse 11 to 15. We have this. While they were going, behold, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests all that had taken place. And when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said, tell people, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble. So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jews to this day. So right there we have confirmation that this was the oldest explanation as to why the tomb was empty and what happened to Jesus' body. This theory implies that the apostles went around proclaiming that Jesus rose from the dead with full knowledge that he had not, which means that the apostles went willingly to their deaths for a lie. Now this obviously does not make any sense, because the disciples would not have gone to their deaths unless they were absolutely convinced that Jesus had indeed risen from the dead, which rules out this theory. And besides, how were they able to get past the Roman guards? Professional soldiers who could potentially lose their heads if they mess up their jobs do not allow thieves to access tombs that easily. Also, how were they able to roll away that massive stone that blocked the entrance to Jesus' tomb? This theory is simply ridiculous at face value, and no serious skeptic today would ever postulate it, although some people on the internet do occasionally bring it back up every once in a while. Moving on, I would like to discuss another theory, which is a little more well-known and a little more popular, which is the swoon theory. This was popular during the 19th century, but had fallen out of popularity in recent years. Main proponents today are members of the heterodox Ahmadiyya sect of Islam, introduced in the writings of their founder, Mirza Ghulam Ahmed, in the book Jesus in India, as well as a few Sunni Muslim apologists such as Ahmadidat and Shabir Ali. Basically, this theory says that Jesus only appeared to die on the cross. Actually, he fainted and he was resuscitated in the tomb, was able to climb out and to present himself alive to his disciples. I think we already discussed this in Stephen's presentation, but there's a lot more medical evidence to show that it is quite false. If you look up a certain article that was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association called On the Physical Death of Jesus Christ, there's a lot of medical evidence that shows that Jesus could not have possibly survived the crucifixion. If anyone wants to know, it's On the Physical Death of Jesus Christ. The authors are William D. Edwards, Wesley Gable, and Floyd Hosmer. And the abstract of this article says, and I quote, Jesus of Nazareth underwent Jewish and Roman trials, was flogged, and was sentenced to death by crucifixion. The scourging produced deep, stripe-like lacerations and appreciable blood loss. It probably set the stage for hypovolemic shock, as evidenced by the fact that Jesus was too weakened to carry the crossbar to Golgotha. At the site of the crucifixion, his wrists were nailed to the patibulum, and after the patibulum was lifted onto upright posts, his feet were nailed to the stipes. The major pathophysiologic effect of crucifixion was an interference with normal respirations. Accordingly, Jesus Accordingly, death resulted primarily from hypovolemic shock and exhaustion, asphyxia. Jesus' death was ensured by the thrust of a soldier's spear into his side. Modern medical interpretation of the historical evidence indicates that Jesus was dead when taken down from the cross. So these are medical experts confirming that Jesus, in fact, died on the cross. And I'm showing you some images from the article itself. This is an image of the scourging that Jesus went through. Actually, the article goes into some detail about it. It says, and I quote, "The usual instrument was a short whip, a flagellum, or with several single or braided leather thongs of variable lengths, in which small iron balls or sharp pieces of sheep bones were tied at intervals. Occasionally, staves were also used. For scourging, the man was stripped of his clothing and his hands were tied to an upright post. The back, buttocks, and legs were flogged either by two soldiers or by one who alternated positions. The severity of the scourging depended on the disposition of the lictors and was intended to weaken the victim to a state just short of collapse or death." Which means that even before Jesus was on the cross, he was already in a state that was dangerously close to death. And furthermore, we have a picture here of the crossbeam. Now, contrary to popular imagination, Jesus did not carry the whole cross, because the whole cross was 300 pounds. No man could possibly carry that. Instead, he carried the horizontal crossbeam, which would have weighed 75 pounds. Now, a man who had just been flogged isn't going to carry that one easily. You have the nailing of the hands and the feet, and the nails would go right through the main nerve that runs through your hands, and that would produce some very exquisite pain. And finally, you have the actual death resulting from the crucifixion. The article goes on to state, "Jesus' death after only 3 to 6 hours on the cross surprised even Pontius Pilate. The fact that Jesus cried out in a loud voice and then bowed his head and died suggests the possibility of a catastrophic terminal event. One popular explanation has been that Jesus died of cardiac rupture. However, another explanation may be more likely. Jesus' death may have been hastened simply by a state of exhaustion and by the severity of his scourging, with its resultant blood loss and pre-shock state. A fatal cardiac arrhythmia may have accounted for the apparent catastrophic terminal event." I would strongly encourage people to get a hold of the article. It is available on the internet if you just search for it. I think that the medical case is quite closed, so we can safely discount the swoon theory. In fact, we didn't have to wait till modern medical science came along to tell us that, because even in the 19th century, it was already falling out of favor. Besides, even if Jesus had somehow survived all the tortures inflicted on him, from the scourging to the piercing, there is no way somebody that heavily injured could possibly have moved the stone covering the tomb and walked all the way to the disciples with bloody feet. 19th century skeptic David Strauss dismissed the swoon theory, saying, "It is impossible that a being who had stolen half dead out of the sepulcher, who crept about weak and ill and wanting medical treatment, could have given the disciples the impression that he was a conqueror over death and the grave, the prince of life, an impression that lay at the bottom of their future ministry." Moving on, we go to the hallucination theory. And this is the theory that the disciples experienced hallucinations of Jesus appearing to them after death, which induced them to believe that he had been resurrected. This is the most common view among the new atheists, the camp that, you know, praises Dawkins, Hitchens, and the like. A good representative of this view is the skeptic Richard Carrier, who states, and I quote, "I believe the best explanation, consistent with both scientific findings and the surviving evidence, is that the first Christians experienced hallucinations of the risen Christ of one form or another." Now, I don't know what scientific findings Richard Carrier could appeal to support this, because there are many problems with theory. There are many things that the theory fails to account for. For example, how the tomb got empty. Because even if the disciples had hallucinated the resurrection of Jesus, that doesn't explain where the body went. Because if the body was still in the tomb, all the Roman soldiers or the Jews had to do was pull it out of the tomb and then present it, showing that Jesus was in fact dead. The fact that they did not do that shows that the tomb was indeed empty, and the hallucinations are more than just that. Also, the hallucination theory fails to account for group eyewitness accounts. Psychologist Gary Collins notes, "Hallucinations are individual occurrences. By their very nature, only one person can see a given hallucination at a time. They aren't something which can be seen by a group of people. Neither is it possible that one person could somehow induce a hallucination in somebody else. Since a hallucination exists only in this subjective personal sense, it's obvious that others cannot witness it." And of course, there are also conversions of people who could not have possibly been induced to have these hallucinations, such as the skeptical half-brother of Jesus, James, as well as St. Paul. See, only certain types of people are prone to hallucinations: those who are high-strung, highly imaginative, and highly nervous. Well, one can make the case that maybe one or two of the witnesses match some of these criteria. One cannot possibly explain away all the people who claim to have seen Jesus simply too imaginative and nervous. I mean, truly, what could have possibly induced a Christian-hating Pharisee such as Paul to see the risen Lord, unless that was an actual event that took place? I would have to conclude, along with the historian Dr. Gary Ambermas, that these individuals in each of these various circumstances would all be candidates for hallucinations really stretches the limits of credibility. Finally, we go to the Islamic substitution theory, which is the theory that we're almost always going to encounter when we talk to our Muslim friends. Basically, this theory states that somebody else was made to look like Jesus and was nailed to the cross in his place. This is based on a certain passage of the Quran, which is Surah An-Nisa. And the passage basically says this: وَقَالِيَنْ إِنَّكَ تَلْنَا أَلْمَسِيْهُ إِسَىٰ بِنْ مَرِيمُ رَسُولُهُ وَمَا قَتَلُهُ مَا صَلَبُهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِهَ لَهُمْ وَإِنَّا لَذِنَّا اِكْتِلَافُ فِيهِ لَفِي شَكٍ مِّنْهُ مَا لَهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ عِلْمٍ إِلَّا تِبْعَى أَظَنِّي وَمَا قَتْلُهُ يَكِينًا بَلْ رَفْعَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. In English, they said, "We killed Jesus Christ, the son of Mary, the messenger of Allah. But they killed him not nor crucified him, but so it was made to appear to them, and those who differ therein are full of doubts with no knowledge, but only conjecture to follow. Surely they killed him not. Nay, Allah raised him up to himself, and Allah is powerful, wise." This passage is by no means clear. The most common interpretation of it is the one that I just mentioned, which is someone else being made to look like Jesus and crucified in his place, which is a problem. There are other Quranic passages which speak of Jesus dying. For example, Surah Ali Imran, that's the third surah, verse 55. And Surah Maryam, ayah 33, also says that Jesus speaks of his own death. It has Jesus saying, and I would quote, "So peace is on me the day I was born, the day that I die, and the day that I shall be raised up to life again." So if Jesus speaks of his death here, which contradicts the idea that Jesus didn't die, to get around this, there's this interpretation that was developed that this refers to an event that happened in the future when Jesus comes back in the last days. This is a post hoc interpretation that the Quran itself never provides. Also, as Islam scholar Todd Lawson points out in The Crucifixion and the Quran, a book which I have right here, there was no unanimity among the early and medieval commentators on the interpretation of this passage. In fact, there are conflicting interpretations even until now. He states regarding the ayah in question, "Muslim teaching on the life and ministry of Jesus is by no means consistent or monolithic. There are numerous forces at work in various levels of the Islamic Quran tradition that impinge upon the hermeneutic culture out of which doctrine may be thought to have arisen and endured. Any number of readers, Muslim or not, could read and have read the same verse without coming to this conclusion. According to Professor Lawson, the most likely interpretation is that Jesus did indeed die physically, but did not die spiritually. He states that the semantic constitution of such a statement strongly points to a reading that would go well beyond the mundane realms of murder and physical death. Support for this interpretation comes from cross-referencing Surah 4157 with Surahs 2154 and 3169, which say more or less the same thing. Basically, it says, "And say not of those who are slain in the way of Allah, they are dead. Nay, they are living, though he perceive it not." And this view, of course, is held to this day by the Ismaili sect of Shi'ism. Ironically, the earliest evidence of 4157 being interpreted as a denial of Jesus' physical death comes not from Muslim commentators, but from the medieval church father, John of Damascus. This is all information that you can find in Lawson's book. Now, the common Muslim belief has a troubling implication that Allah deceived the masses into deceiving that Jesus died on the cross, when in fact he didn't. This would mean that Allah inadvertently started Christianity by an act of deception. There is a further problem with this, and which is best encapsulated by what I call this Islamic dilemma. The Quran states that Allah aided Jesus' disciples, who are regarded as Muslims, promising that they would be superior over the unbelievers until the day of resurrection. It's in Surah Al Imran 355, Surah As-Saff, which is 61, Ayah 14. Now, this raises some interesting questions. Were the disciples tricked into believing that Jesus died and rose again? If yes, then they were no better than the unbelievers, and Allah did not keep his promise. On the other hand, if the answer is no, then where did their message go? One may say that it was lost or corrupted by unbelievers, but if that is so, that means that the disciples were not aided by Allah or made superior over the unbelievers, and this would nullify the Quran's word entirely. You can follow the train of logic in the chart right behind me. It's also made available in one of our tracks, the Quran and the Injil, which you can get through us. The only way that a Muslim can hold to Surah 4157 without contradiction is to reject the common interpretation that it is denying the physical death of Jesus. In conclusion, we see, based on the examination of the presuppositions behind the alternative theories, that they are internally inconsistent and unable to account for history as it is. Thus, we can safely discard them as unsound. The resurrection of Jesus Christ remains the only valid explanation for the historical facts. All other explanations simply do not have a solid historical foundation to stand on, which is why we can say with St. Paul, as he wrote in 1 Corinthians 15:20, "But in fact Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. And because he has been raised, we have hope for the resurrection of our own bodies at the end of days." But all I've presented for you thus far is a negative case showing that the alternatives are false. So we will provide for you a positive case. And George Simopoulos, I think, will be providing that one in short order.
Hi, everyone. I just want to say it's an absolute pleasure to be here just to share these insights, things that I have been researching, things that I have come to understand. It really is a pleasure to explain these things from an apologetic standpoint, not only because we have an obligation to give a defense for the reasons, for the hope that we have in us, but this is also a reassurance for what we believe. This is edifying for us, and it was certainly edifying for me to do this research and to relay it to you. So I'm going to be doing my segment of the presentation on the positive case for the resurrection. If we look at 1 Corinthians 15, we have to listen to what St. Paul says when he says that if Christ has not risen from the grave, we are the most to be pitied. Well, hopefully my presentation will help you see that this is not the case, that Christ has risen from the grave, that this is something that we can believe and that we can proclaim and bring to people. Well, actually, to start off with, I'm going to talk about the nature of evidence itself. evidence is somewhat misunderstood. It's kind of seen as something that's a brute fact, but evidence is actually facts that have been interpreted. It's not simply a brute fact. So evidence requires interpretation, and there are three sorts of levels of evidence. The first is a proof. This is the kind of proof that we see in mathematics. 1 + 1 = 2. Now this is the golden prize of evidence. If we can get to that point, we've come on to something true. And I'm going to show you that that's actually the case with the resurrection. The second point is corroborative evidence. This is evidence that, if we look at a legal dictionary, it's what strengthens, adds to, or confirms already existing evidence. And the example that's oftentimes used regards to the resurrection are the lives of the transformed disciples. So these people, having seen the resurrected Jesus, went on to live transformed lives. They were willing to give up all their worldly possessions, to hold them in common, and to die for what they have seen. Now, many people can be deceived into believing something and would die for it, but there's not a single person who's willing to give up everything, including their lives, for what they know to be a lie. So, that is one compelling piece of evidence for corroborative evidence, but I'm going to try to tease that out in greater detail. So, and evidence for that very claim is 1 John 1-3, which says, "That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ." One of the most common criticisms of the resurrection was that it was a developing legend, that the early Christians simply were a development of a form of Judaism that came out of Palestine. And they oftentimes say that, you know what, the person of Jesus, the miracles that he performed, his resurrection, were something that happened later. This is a legend, sort of like Hercules. There may have been a guy by the name of Hercules, but he certainly wasn't strong enough to kill these mythological beasts, which obviously don't even exist. So the best evidence actually comes from the Bible itself, internal testimony. If we can look at 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3-5, which Stephen brought up, says, "For I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures." Now, a creed is an oral formulation of foundational points that are not only to be believed, but are what to give yourselves to. So credo, it has this sort of connotation of something you give your heart to. The oral formulation of this creed is actually quite clear based on evidence that we have from that time and place. So the words "delivered" and "received" are in fact technical Greek terms to describe a tradition that's being passed on. This is actually very significant. It would be as if Paul were saying that this is what's been passed down to me. This is a tradition. He's actually referring to a creed that was passed down by the early church. See, 1 Corinthians was written in the 50s, 50 AD. This is about 20, 25 years after the resurrection. But he is appealing to a tradition which actually goes way before his penning of 1 Corinthians. Critical scholars say that this formulation of a creed dates back to about 3 to 6 years after the resurrection. So this is a very early creed. The early Christians believed that Christ has risen from the grave. The second evidence is that the Hebrew narration patterns and triple usage of "and that" and two references to scriptures being fulfilled show that this is an early church. These are not Gentile believers. These are first generation Christians, Jews who had converted to Christianity because they have seen the risen Christ. And the third point is that it's structured in parallel form. So memorization was very important in societies where written documents were in short supply or were expensive. So today we oftentimes marvel at someone who can remember a psalm, but in those days people memorized entire books. The Iliad, it's a book about this thick. was actually memorized by many Greeks, and they can recite it verbatim. So being able to memorize something was very important, and the way they did that was by structuring things in parallel form. The mind is better able to memorize something if it's done in a pattern, which is why we are much more able to memorize songs, because songs typically follow a pattern. And it's the same thing with creeds. If they were in a parallel form, you could memorize them and you could recite them at command. So the second point are the linguistic signatures of the creed. Now, this is actually very interesting. Linguistic signature is basically, it's like a fingerprint that you have in your writing. So if we were to take a collection of your writings, imagine this, we take everything you write, we can actually analyze fingerprints on the words that you use. They're like the little ridges in your finger. There's something, what you write is specific to who you are. And what we have in this creed is distinctively non-Pauline signatures. So here's a list of some of the signatures that are clearly non-Pauline. He says, for our sins, according to the scriptures, he has been raised. Third day, he has seen the 12. Now, this is something that is written by someone else. And this only adds further credence to the idea that this is actually a creed that predates Paul, which is what most critical scholars believe. Now, I want to get away from the internal testimony for just a moment to get into circumstantial evidence. Now, circumstantial evidence is not the strongest form of evidence, but it is important. So in crime scenes, if someone leaves a fingerprint at a scene of a crime, let's say leaves it on a murder weapon, that's actually enough to warrant a conviction. And we should have the same sorts of standards when we are trying to formulate a position on doctrine. So let's look at this picture right here, the little dog. He has obviously some red on his face and in his paws. Maybe he fell into some paint and obviously messed up the carpet. Now, you might see red on the carpet and you'd say, whoa, who did that? And you might see your dog and he has red on his paws and on his mouth. Now, it's not necessarily the case that the dog caused the spill, but it's certainly likely that he did. Now, obviously, I say this just to labor the point that circumstantial evidence is powerful, but it's not the most sound, but it is useful in a court setting. Now, two forms of circumstantial evidence that I would appeal to are actually what we hold to be very precious in our churches, and that's baptism and the Lord's Supper. Now, if we look at Romans 6:4, we see what baptism is. Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. Baptism was based on the analogy that Jesus died and was raised to life. How meaningless would it be for these early Christians to participate in this rite, in this ceremony, if it did not have significance? Imagine just, okay, we're an early first century Jewish movement, we're gonna dip you in some water and you're done, great. Now you don't smell as bad. Whoop-de-doo, that's meaningless. So baptism has significance of being brought down into death and rising in new life, just as Christ has been. The second point is the Lord's Supper. Now Michael Green, a scholar on this, says, this was no memorial feast in honor of a dead founder. Believers broke bread with exultation because they believed the risen Lord was in their midst as they took tokens of his death for them. It would have been a complete travesty had the earliest Christians not believed that Jesus rose from the grave. So Jesus' life is being given to the believer in communion. This would make no sense for early Christians to participate in this sacrament if it was not significant, if it was not meaningful, if it was not tied to the resurrection. And we know that this is what early Christians were practicing. So just a summary of some of these points. Creeds affirming the, so the first is that creeds affirm the resurrection as being very early. The second is that the early church practices put triumphant import to the death of Christ. Third, that the earliest eyewitnesses were willing to die because of their experience. Fourth, that the stolen body and fraud theories are disproven by the disciples' experiences and by their transformation, based on what Lewis had presented. So based on these points alone, we can say that Christ is risen. This is on the internal evidence of Scripture. Now, most critical scholars don't accept Scripture because of their own presuppositions, but we will get into that. What I am saying is that from a clear reading of Scripture, reading it critically, understanding when it was written, that it was early in its formulation of Christ's resurrection, we can say with utmost certainty in a courtroom context that Christ is risen. But a lot of people will appeal to outside sources. They will say, well, okay, fine, that's your sacred text. Of course, it's going to be consistent within itself. But what about non-Christian sources? What about the Romans and the Jews? Well, I think we can say something compelling to that as well. So some corroborative evidence to that would be Luke's census. Now, we've all read the Gospel of Luke in the beginning when it talks about the Romans calling for a census, calling people from all over Judea to go to the land of their birth and to provide an account for their possessions and where they live. Now, if you look at the Titulus Venitus, it's actually, yes, Venitus, indicates a census took place in 5 to 6 AD, and that such censuses were common in the time of Augustus. Censuses were usually conducted about every 14 years or so. And the ancient Latin inscription called the Titulus Venitus indicates that it was written in Syria and Judea, and that its indications are that the census took place every 14 years. So, is there any background for this census? And there is. Censuses were important to the economic and political stability of the Roman Empire and were used to great effect in keeping an eye on the captured territory. So historians used to question the account in Luke's Gospel regarding the Roman census, but this important inscription, the Titulus Venitus, actually helps us see how common such practices were. The Romans needed to have a grip on their empire, and this was one of the ways they did it. So we can say that there is corroborative evidence to what is being accounted for in Luke's Gospel and in the other Gospels. But this obviously is not the most, it might not win your non-believing friend. So let's move on to the next one, the Nazareth Decree. I find this one the most interesting, actually. So it was an ordinance that was given by Caesar. He says, "It is my pleasure that graves and tombs remain perpetually undisturbed for those who have made them for a cult or for their ancestors or children or members of their house. If, however, anyone charges that another has either demolished them or has in another way extracted the buried or has maliciously transferred them to other places in order to wrong them or has displaced the ceiling on other stones, against such a one, I order that a trial be instituted as in respect of the gods, so in regard to the cult of mortals, for it shall be much more obligatory to honor the buried. Let it be absolutely forbidden for anyone to disturb them. In case of violation, I desire that the offender be sentenced to capital punishment on charge of violation of the sepulcher." Look at that right there. This was an inscription that was given in Nazareth that called for capital punishment for the disturbing of a tomb. Now you might say, why would they do this? This inscription was actually made after a riot that took place in Rome in 49 AD. This is about 10 years, roughly 10 to 15 years after the resurrection. A riot took place in Rome because the Jews were debating an issue about Christ. Suetonius, a Roman historian, said that these Jews had revolted in Rome because of an issue caused by this fellow by the name of Crispus. Well, what was that dispute? What caused the Jews to revolt? Well, inscription gives us a good picture into what it might have been. The emperor is saying that if there is someone who's been maliciously removed from a tomb, which is what the Jews were saying, then this adds further evidence, further proof to the fact that Jesus was gone from the tomb, that the tomb was empty, and that the Jews were spreading the things that the Gospels say that they were. This adds credence to the Scriptures, and it adds credence to the point that Christ has risen. Well, let's look to the next piece of evidence, the Talmud. I'll read you a piece from the Talmud. It says, on the eve of the Passover, Yeshua was hanged. For 40 days before the execution took place, a herald went forth and cried, he is going forth to be stoned because he has practiced sorcery and enticed Israel to apostasy. Anyone who can say anything in his favor, let him come forward and plead on his behalf. But since nothing was brought forward in his favor, he was hanged on the eve of the Passover. So we can see that a lot of information contained here is consistent with what is actually said in the Gospels. But obviously it disagrees on the fundamental point that Christ was hanged on a cross and was crucified unjustly and was risen from the grave. So what is the Talmud, you might be asking? The Talmud is actually, it's not a commentary on Scripture, but it's actually a restatement of written laws. And the Talmud was written about 200 to 600 AD, and it was a rabbinic discussion on Jewish law. Now, this section of the Talmud here is part of the Mishnah. The Mishnah is a tradition in the Talmud that is the earliest. It starts from 70 AD, which is when the Temple of Jerusalem was destroyed and ended in 200. So this is the earliest formulation of the Jewish understanding of Jesus. Right here. This is what the earliest Jews were saying about Jesus. And they were obviously holding to their guns, so to speak. And they articulated, in a period from 70 to about 200 AD. So the next point is Josephus. Now, we have two documents from Josephus. One is the Greek text, and one is the Arabic text. The Greek text, it's very interesting. It actually says that Christ may have been the Messiah. Those are Josephus' words. But many historians will discredit the Greek text because they don't like that Josephus is saying that. So I'm going to be quoting from the Arabic text, which doesn't include that. But mind you, the Arabs also had an interest in not including that Jesus was the Christ as well. So, many people say that the Greek text was altered. It might actually be the Arabic text. We can't be sure, but I'm going to use the weakest evidence to also show that it still makes a compelling case for the resurrection. And Josephus says, At this time, there was a wise man who was called Jesus. His conduct was good, and he was known to be virtuous. And many people from among the Jews and other nations became his disciples. Pilate condemned him to be crucified and to die. But those who had become his disciples did not abandon his discipleship. They reported that he had appeared to them 3 days after his crucifixion, and that he was alive. Accordingly, he was perhaps the Messiah, concerning whom the prophets have recounted wonders. So, Josephus here clearly believed in the resurrection. Well, in a broad resurrection, he believed in what the Pharisees were saying. But he is bringing a light of doubt on Jesus, saying that he was a virtuous man, his disciples followed him. He may have done this, but it's not necessarily conclusive. But Josephus still stands as a key point of evidence for the resurrection, for extra-biblical evidence that it is in fact the case that Jesus has risen. So I think I've provided enough internal testimony and extra-biblical evidence to show that the resurrection is well accounted for, that the empty tomb is something that historians have to grapple with. But I'm going to actually right now go into the heart of the issue, because we can talk about the resurrection, we can talk about the empty tomb, but we're not going to get anywhere unless we talk about biblical presuppositions. So remember I was talking about fact and meaning, that its evidence is a fact that requires interpretation? Well, that is the case. All facts require interpretation. The human mind can't simply deal with brute facts. And I included that picture of the fist with the word fact in it, because many people see things as brute facts, as if facts are simply taken at face value. But our mind is actually designed in such a way to take these facts and to provide an interpretation almost instantaneously, because we were designed to do that. So, you can't actually go from the empty tomb to being that Jesus was resurrected. And you can't even go from Jesus being resurrected to Jesus is God. The two aren't actually the same. You can't equate the two. I actually remember a friend of mine, we were talking at a dinner table, and he said, you know what, even if Jesus did rise from the grave, that doesn't prove that he's the Messiah. That doesn't prove that our sins have been forgiven, and that doesn't prove that he's God. And I thought to myself, yeah, that's actually true. You can't say that because Jesus rose from the grave that he's God. That's because facts require interpretation. We can't simply take a fact, rip it out of its context, and simply say that it means something. Jesus is God because the Bible says it, because it's self-disclosed testimony. It is authority unto itself, and it is the foundation for all knowledge, all predicate knowledge. We can know that Jesus is risen from the grave because God has revealed it. Now, that might sound like a very fundamentalist position. I believe it because the Bible says it's true. But everyone does this. Every single person does this, whether they recognize this or not. Cornelius Van Til said, the resurrection of Christ is a fact, the meaning of which will be unintelligible to us unless we think of it as related to the system of Christian truth as a unit. If people say that my creed is only that Jesus rose from the grave, I'm sorry, that's wrong. Jesus rose from the grave because God has revealed it in the full counsel of his revelation. You can't isolate the resurrection. You can't isolate the good news without all the rest. God has placed the resurrection, has placed the gospel in the midst of his overarching plan for redemption. And it's something that he has revealed in his scriptures. So I'm going to talk about presuppositions a little bit. So what is a presupposition, you might be thinking? Well, it's something that we have to assume at the beginning of an argument in order to make sense of an argument. What? That kind of sounds like circular reasoning. You start from a premise and you end up with a premise that's absurd. But that's actually what many people do. That's what everyone does. So I'll take naturalism as an example. Naturalism is a philosophy that says, well, we are stardust, our senses are reliable, therefore science is reliable. And the way that they go about doing this is they say that our senses are reliable, science is reliable, and because I believe that God does not exist and that I'm stardust, this must be the case. See, there's no reason for them to actually believe that their senses are reliable and that science is reliable simply because they're made from stardust. That's something that they assume and they end with because their science leads them to the conclusion that they're stardust. But you see, they start with it and they end with it. That's not something necessarily bad. We do that as well. We say, from the biblical revelatory position, we say, we were created to understand God through the world. Our senses are reliable, therefore science is reliable. But which one actually makes more sense? Which one corresponds to reality? Well, the first one says that I'm just a collection of atoms. Well, think about this for a second. If I took a bottle of Diet Pepsi and I put it next to a bottle of Dr. Pepper, and I shook them up real nicely, and I put them next to each other, and I asked them, who shot Abraham Lincoln? Should I expect to get an intelligible response? Of course not. You can't ask a question of meaning to nothing but a collection of atoms. Atoms are simply facts. They're simply atoms. They can't account for their own existence. But if you say that we were created to understand God, we were given the cognitive faculties to understand the world and to have dominion over it, to glorify God, then we can say that our senses are reliable and that science is reliable because God has made it that way. And so we reason in the circle, and our circle makes better sense of the world. So let's apply this same sort of hermeneutic, this way to interpret reality, with the resurrection. So, it's often said that the meaning of the resurrection is a theological matter, but the fact of the resurrection, now that's a historical matter. Have you guys ever heard that? Yeah. It's actually completely bogus. It's wrong. We can't say this as Christians. There's no such thing as neutral history. We have to interpret history by a set of presuppositions. Now you might say, well, no, I've gone to university. I interpreted history quite consistently, thank you very much. Well, let me just tell you, the university likes to dis- likes to pass off their methodologies as neutral. But in fact, the methodology that's very popular in universities today is what's known as historical materialism. This was a method of interpreting history that was developed by the philosopher by the name of Karl Marx. Does anyone know Karl Marx? Yeah. Karl Marx, he was the one that actually developed this term. And the basic presupposition of historical materialism is that we are material, nothing more than that. We are a collection of atoms, that our only interest is economic, and so all of history has to be read with the intention that man's purpose is to accumulate economic self-sufficiency and reliability. Okay, that's one way to interpret history, and that's why you get a lot of these studies today, like post-colonial studies, that the whole purpose of the West was to exploit the regions of the world in order to provide economic self-sufficiency. Okay, that's the way that they interpret history. But if we start with biblical revelation, we were not created, well, that's also requires qualification. We were not created for economic self-sufficiency. We were created to know and glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. So, what are the implications? Let's go through all the points. Jesus was hanged on a Roman cross. We know that. The tomb was empty. We know that. These are historically verifiable. There were 500 witnesses who claimed to have seen Jesus after His death, including Paul. The earliest Christians claimed Jesus rose from the grave. And we also know that the alleged eyewitnesses died for their belief. I said earlier that no one dies for a lie. These people claimed to have seen Jesus and were willing to die for it. Okay, well, how do you make sense of that? And this is what I'm going to be concluding with. The first one is naturalism. This is what's oftentimes passed off as scientific and credible and academic. And it says, well, God cannot interact with the world, if He even exists. So Jesus must have been replaced, or the disciples must have hallucinated, or Jesus only appeared to die on the cross. Well, if Lewis's presentation is to be believed, which I think he made a very compelling case, those points are actually not true. They're self-contradictory, they're incoherent, and they cannot actually provide a comprehensive understanding of history. Okay, well then let's try the alternative. Biblical revelation. Does this make sense of reality? Can we say that this is how God has disclosed Himself? Well, let's give it a shot. It says, God created the world so that He might be glorified, and He is sovereign over the world. Jesus' death on the cross secured the forgiveness of His sins, of His people's sin, and His resurrection was proof that sin and death had been conquered. Now, God does exist. God has created us for a purpose. Included in that purpose is that we understand the world around us through our senses, through science, and through history. And because of that, He has told us that He has decided to take our sins away, to make us clean, to make us His children. Which one of those two can make sense of the world? Is the one where we're stardust and we can't even interpret facts? Or is it the other one, where we were created to know the universe, that we can know the universe, and it's for a purpose? This is what I leave to you. Remember, presuppositions play into every single set of questions. Do not neglect them. There is no neutral approach to history, and biblical revelation provides the best, most suitable explanation, not only for the resurrection, but for life as a whole, because we can know with assurance that our lives are part of God's redemptive plan. Thank you.